welcome all of you to the first webinar of our series about debugging or specific topics about debugging with UDE. The first webinar today is about multi-core debugging with UDE. And here in this webinar, we will look at the UDE's multi-core debugging features for multi-core microcontrollers. I have prepared a live demo, which is based on an Infineon Oryx and a Renesas R-Car. But actually, the features that I will show during the live demo are generally available also for other multi-core controllers that we support with UDE. So at first, I'd like to start with an overview of what you can expect in the next few minutes. Mainly, I will show you in a live demo some of the basics of using UDE and the basic multi-core debugging functions. But before, let me give you a short introduction into the typical debugging scenarios that we have with multi-core architectures. And this will help us to understand the different debugging features of UDE and for what purposes they are used. So let's start with that slide. Here we show two typical examples of multi-core targets that are supported by UDE. These are deeply embedded multi-core SoCs. We have a ARM-based device from NXP, the S32G, and the Oryx device. This is an example of a second generation Oryx. In contrast to multi-core architectures that we know for years and used in PCs or in consumer electronics, these kind of multi-core controllers address a completely different application domain. So automotive, for example, or industrial, and something like that. So basically everything that needs real-time capabilities and also safety features. Typically, we have a mix of different core architectures. For example, a combination of core clusters of the same architecture, plus domain-specific or application-specific cores based on different architectures. For example, such a domain-specific or application-specific core is the GTM, or even also the HSM. The GTM provides powerful functions for complex timers and signal generation, and it's a Bosch IP. And the HSM is the hardware security module that adds some safety and security features to those kind of microcontrollers. So in the near future, we also expect some AI accelerators to be present in such kind of multi-core systems. For example, for the third generation of the Oryx, the PPU, the parallel processing unit. Of course, this mix of homogeneous and heterogeneous cores significantly influences the software architecture and of course also the debugging. So let's have a look at the software architecture for such a system. The simplest software architecture is certainly a single core application. If you bring this onto a multi-core system, then several single core applications can be executed in parallel on such a system. Each application comes with its own binary or ELF file and uses its own core. There are no or only minimal dependencies between them, and so debugging will in most cases focus on only one of the applications or one of the cores at a time. All the debug actions, especially actions for run control, for example, break, step, go, should be performed only on this core that is in focus. The opposite case is a monolithic multi-core application. The tasks and functions are distributed over all the available cores. So we have close dependencies between the cores and need synchronization of debug actions. All the cores must, for example, be stopped synchronously if the application hits a breakpoint. You have to synchronize, for example, single stepping. So if you execute the instructions step by step, or even if you make a go action, then all the cores should be started synchronously. Otherwise, you will get an inconsistent application state immediately. And then we have, of course, a mix of both corner cases, different code bases and binaries for different cores, for example. For example, for the main cores and a GTM or an HSM. And for these cases, there may be a need for perform debug actions only on a subset of the cores. So we need a partial debug synchronization. So with all this in mind, we can now start and create a debug session in UDE. So that you will see in a minute. Before I would, I'd like to give you a short introduction into the concept of a debug session or workspace. And you will see in a minute that creating a debug session with UDE from scratch is quite simple. Before we start, from now on, I will use the term workspace for a debugger session. This is also the term that you will find in UDE. So a workspace contains everything that you need to perform some debug tasks. It contains a target configuration, we call it target configuration, which contains itself the information which target will be debugged, which interface is used for the connection to the target, so the debug interface, JTAG, SWD, DAP, or something like that. Then it contains also the information to which cores of the target the debugger should be connected. And also there are some target specific settings, for example, to disable a watchdog, which would destroy your debug session. The application itself is also part of the workspace. So you select the application that should be run on the target and maybe loaded into the flash memory. And then, of course, all the settings and customizations of your user interface. So, for example, which windows you want to see, which information should be presented from your target system. Of course, the workspace can be saved and loaded on the next day, for example, when you continue your work. And this is, that helps a lot that you can, that you have your environment available the next day out of the box. So let's get started with the first example I'd like to show on the UDE. The first example addresses the use case of a monolithic application that is distributed over the main cores of an Oryx system. The binary and the debug information is included in one ELF file. And we have here some functions in our code that are shared between different cores of this Oryx system. And the GTM is in this case not used. This makes things simpler in this case. So the hardware setup looks like that. We have a tri-board with an Oryx TC39. And this is connected using the device access port, which is an Infineon specific debug interface to the debugger probe, our UID2 Pro, which is connected using USB to my PC here. And the DAP is adapt connected to our UAD2 Pro by this little JTAG DAP target adapter. And that's the only target specific part in our debugger toolchain, which is the debugger software itself, the UAD2 Pro access device, and the target adapter. Okay, then let's jump to the UDE and start with creating a debugging session workspace from scratch. The first step is open the file menu, use the new workspace action item here, and give the workspace a name, for example, TC3. T339 new, something like that. And then UDE asks for the already mentioned target configuration. So I can select one of this list if there are any present. But if you start with a new workspace and with a session from scratch, you can use the default button and can select from a huge list of all the supported target systems and target architectures. And also, if you unfold, for example, the TriCore Oryx 2G from Infineon, then you can select the specific device and then the specific evaluation board. So for almost all the supported microcontrollers, we provide such a predefinition of a target configuration. So you can simply start with some of these target configurations, even if you have a custom board or a custom hardware. So we use the tri-board with a TC39B step connected by the device access port. Press finish, and then we can save this file. I have already one that I'd like to use because I have two UADs here on my desk. So you can also select the UAD you want to connect within the target configuration. So I use this with the UAD 2 Pro connected to the to my tripod here specified, and then press OK. And then UDE asks which cores you want to see in the debugger session. So I'd like to have it in the default mode. So all the tri-core cores are checked, and we have no GDM code here, which we want to debug, so we can leave it unchecked. Press OK, and then the UDE connects to the target system. It is indicated here in the message. In the message log window here, all the six cores of this Aurix are connected successfully. And we see that we have only one user environment, and all the six cores are present here in this user environment. We will see it later that we use colors for each core to get a better overview of the overall system by debugging. So what is missing now? We need a target application, of course. We use the load program function here and look for the code that we want to flash into the internal flash memory. I select a pre-compiled ELF file here, which is located for the flash. And then this window pops up, which can be used to specify which core should load the binary, which is contained in the ELF file, into the flash, and for which cores I want to load symbols, that means debug information. So in this case, the default is set as follows. The core zero is the only core which is active after the reset. All the other cores, you can see it here as well, are inactive and have to be woken up by the core zero and core zero application. The only core that can load the application is core zero. So I tick or check this blue checkbox here, which tells, okay, that's for the binary to be loaded. And we want to load the symbol information or the debug information to all the cores that we want to debug. So I leave it unchanged here. So every green checkbox remains ticked, which are the symbols. Then press OK, and then automatically the flash tool is opened. So UDE recognizes that this is a flash located application. Then I can press Program All and exit, and then we can start our application. And then we can, for example, open some windows, for example, a watch window, put it somewhere on the right side, add a variable, which is indicates the running state of the core zero here. Then can enable, we call it periodic refresh. It's simply a real-time watch. So, and so from now on, you can add some windows, add some information that you want to see during your debug session. Then you can save the workspace and load it again if you're finished with your work and start or continue your work tomorrow. I have prepared a workspace which is based on the same application, but I have added some more windows. So I opened this. And I'd like to show you some of the multi-core features. This is the same application. So you see, okay, same settings here for the binary and also for the symbols. And so we can verify if the application already flashed on the Aurix is the same. It is, so we have no differences here. So it's not necessary to flash the application. So you see, okay, we have the application is not running. We can run the application, and you see, okay, every core is now in running mode. So the application running or the functions running on core zero have woken up the other cores here, and everything is running. And then I can make some changes to the user interface. For example, if we concentrate on the core zero, core one, and core two, and if you would have a second screen, for example, then you can put this window out, for example, also the watches here. And this is a new feature or an improved feature in the new UDE 2021, which will be released in the next few days. So that it's very helpful if you have a second screen to keep the overview of your system. The first thing I'd like to show you is how debug synchronization is working. So let us select a function, for example, this one on the core one, and set a breakpoint here. Then you will see, okay, if you hit the breakpoint, then also the core zero is halted, and also the core two is halted. So you see, okay, each window is colored by the core color here. So it's very easy to see, okay, that is the core two window, that is the core one window, that is for the core zero here. And yeah, from now you can sing a step, for example, then you see, okay, every chord is also single stepped here, and you see also in the toolbar the indication that every chord is halted. So you can change this behavior. You can say, okay, I have independent applications, for example, and I want to break only a subset of the cores, and the others should not be touched by the run control. This is very simple, using the multi-core run control configuration that we have. In this run control configuration, there is a group defined of all the cores that should be synchronized for debugging. And I can simply remove some of these cores here from this list. For example, use core 5 or core 4. And then these cores are independent from the debug synchronization. So, but for this application, it makes no sense because it is a monolithic application. Okay. So let's open the breakpoints window here and put this somewhere here. This is the first feature that I'd like to show you for debug synchronization. Also, if I disable this breakpoint and press the go button, then you will see all the cores are now running again synchronously. So the target application is always in a consistent state. I said in the introduction that in this example, we have some shared functions. For example, this one. This is a function which is executed by core 0 and also by core 1 and core 2. So let's have a look at this code, and if you move to the mixed mode, which shows also the machine instruction for both, then you can see, okay, it's the same address. Well, it's the same code, same addresses. And if I set a breakpoint here, for example, in core 1, then you see, okay, the breakpoint is only visible here, but not here. And also if I switch back to the normal mode. So if I now make it go, then you will see we never reach a breakpoint in core 1, for example. But I'm sure that this function is also executed by core 1. So the way would be to add the breakpoint as well for the core 1. Then you will see, okay, we hit the breakpoint now in core 0 and core 1. But if you want to do this for all the cores, it would be very annoying. I forgot to mention that a breakpoint is always a core specific or core local. That means a breakpoint, we are using a breakpoint logic on the hardware for the breakpointing. If you set a breakpoint in one core, then it is only on one core. But we have a nice feature that is called multi-core breakpoint. You can edit, for example, a already existing breakpoint, or add a multi-core breakpoint using the context menu. For example, this is the command for that. And if I add or change this breakpoint to a multi-core breakpoint, then you will see now also our application halts at the execute shared function that is executed by core 2. So it is independent from which core the function is executed, the breakpoint is always active. Okay, and then you will, I'm sure that with three cores visible in the visible in the debugger, it is you can handle the debugging, but if you have six cores, for example, it can be very hard to keep the overview. And for this, also with UDE 2021, we have introduced the concept of perspectives. I have prepared two perspectives here. Perspectives is allows you to focus on a specific debug task. This can be, for example, debugging only core one, so you get only the windows of core one, or another core, or this is not prepared here in this workspace. You can also use perspectives to concentrate or to do a profiling task or a test task with code coverage in parallel or a trace task, etc. So you can for different debug tasks you can define your own perspectives and use them. Okay, so then let's have a look at the other example. I have promised that we also use example on the Renesas Archive. That shows you a more, or will show you a bit more complex software architecture in terms of the applications that should be loaded. This example is running on this Aircar H3, which is a multi-core processor with Cortex A57 cores in a cluster, four cores in one cluster here. And we have a cluster of A53 cores, also four cores. And then we have a R7 core, Cortex R7 core. So, and the application is divided in two parts. We have a multi-core application, and that is running on the Cortex A clusters on both. This application is compiled for a RArch64 instruction set and loaded into the external flash of this device. And from there, it's copied into the internal memory by a bootloader. The application and the bootloader are provided as separate hex files, which containing the binary to be loaded into the flash. And we have a separate ELF file that provides debug information to the debugger of this multi-core application, multi-core demo. And then we have a single-core application, time demo, which is running on the Cortex R7 core. This is compiled separately and uses a 32-bit ARM V7 instruction set. And the binary, came out from the compiler, is linked into the multi-core demo in this hex file here, which I introduced before. And also copied by the multi-core demo into the Cortex R7 RAM. And for that, we provide a separate ELF file that provides the debug information to the debugger. So it's also a combination of two files that we need for debugging. So to simplify this example, only two cores of the A57 cluster should be visible in the debugger, and also the R7 core will be visible in the debugger. And the hardware setup looks quite the same as for the Oryx example. Here we have a evaluation board with an Renesas RCAR starter kit with a RCAR H3. Then this is connected using the SWD by this target specific target adapter here to our UID2 Pro, which is also connected via the USB to the PC. Okay, and then let's jump to UDE again and load a new workspace or a predefined workspace. To be honest, and with this workspace, you will see, okay, also the application is already prepared to be loaded into the Flash or programmed into the Flash, and it looks much more complicated than this monolithic application of the Oryx. So we need a boot header, which is provided as a hex file. The binaries are loaded into the first core of the Cortex-A57 cluster. We have no debug information here, so the checkboxes for the symbols are grayed out. Then we need the MadiCore demo application, also the binary, which is loaded also into the Flash by the Cortex-A57 Core 0. And we have here ticked the hex elf option. That means that automatically UDE looks into the same folder for a multi-core demo.elf file, which contains the debug information. If it's not found there, you get a file open dialog box where you can browse for the appropriate elf file. So this is the part for the Cortex-A cluster. As said before, the MadiCore demo binary file contains also the code for the time demo, which is running on the Cortex-R7, which is then loaded into this the local RAM for this core here. And so we don't need any other binary file. Only the debug information is provided by a separate time demo.elf file. So that's why we check only the simple checkbox here for the Cortex-R7 and also the simple checkboxes for the A cores here for this MadiCore demo. And then I can press OK. The Flash programming tool, we call it mem tool, gets opened again, and then we can program the application. And then before we start or we run the application, I'd like to change the behavior of the debug synchronization here. In this case, it may be useful if you separate debugging for the A cores and the R core. So I want to break the run control management or the run control group, which is by default contains all the cores that are visible in the debugger, and I remove the Cortex R7 core here, and then I start the application. So we see all the cores are running now. The R7 is started by the application running on the Cortex A cluster, and you see here two variables that are indicating the running state. So if I would break here, for example, the Cortex R core or even the one of the Cortex A cores, the timer which is used to increment these variables would also stop and we lose the indication. So I disable the this option here, which holds the timer if the course gets in debug mode. So, and now I can set a breakpoint, for example, here in this main function for the Cortex-R core, for example, at this place here, and you will see, okay, we hit the breakpoint in the Cortex-R, but we don't stop. Let's have a look here. We don't stop all the other cores. And this is a partially unsynchronized debugging case here. And you can here start stepping, for example, or run again. Then we hit the breakpoint again. And we can also stop the, or start this core here. You see the R7 is running and we can stop the A cores. You see the R7 keeps running while the other cores are halted. Okay, so I'd like to wrap up. Time is over. So we have seen that it is very easy to start with UDE and create a new debugger session for a multi-core controller like the Aurix or the R-Car. You need only a few clicks, and with the predefined target configurations that we provide, it's not really magic to get the working workspace here. So, and once you have set up your debug session, UDE provides you with a lot of useful features. First of all, one common user interface for the complete system and not separately for each core. So you need no additional debugger instances for each core that you want to debug everything in one user environment. Core coloring, for example, helps a lot to keep the overview of such complex systems. And also, you can easily customize your environment and tailor to your needs. Multi-screen support and also perspectives helps a lot. I showed you different methods for debug synchronization, fully synchronized on the Aurix, partially synchronized on the R-Car. You can even switch the debug synchronization off. That's useful, for example, if you have completely independent applications running on all the cores. And finally, on the Aurix, I showed you the concept of the multi-core breakpoints, which also helps a lot if you have shared code and you don't know which core is executing the shared code actually. So that's all for today. Thank you very much for your attention.